So we have been studying free vibration of damped systems, right? So first, we define what the problem is, then we realize that depending on what we introduce as the damping ratio, which is a physical characteristic of a system defined as the damping coefficient over the critical value of the damping, which we realized was this. Okay, we have three, we encounter three cases. If this is greater than one, we call that overdamped. If it is equal to one, we call that critically damped system. And if it is less than one, underdamped. Okay. These two cases, we had an exponentially decaying, okay, response, non-periodic, and non-periodic. And in this case, we had a periodic, or harmonic actually, response with exponentially decaying amplitude. So we solved the simple problem to show the difference in terms of the response. We know what the response looks like. In this case, was just sum of two exponential functions. This one was the product of a linear, time-dependent linear function and an exponential function. In this case, we had an exponential time-dependent function, which was the amplitude times a harmonic part, okay? So, the problems that you come across in free vibration basically are this, that in other words, we study this case to do two things. First of all, we want to know how in the case of a damped system, derive the equation of motion, derive the equation of motion, or in other words, similar to the undamped system, how do we set up this model? Okay? So that means we need to find a K equivalent, C equivalent, mass equivalent, and set up this model. That's reason one, okay, or objective one to study these. Objective two is we want to see actually the application of this case, and in particular, since most systems are underdamped, we want to see the application. Most importantly, in finding or evaluating the critical, the damping ratio of the system. So I'm going to do a few problems in this case, then we will introduce this concept and how we do that. So let's just start. I will do two reasonably good problems, okay? So let's start with this one. Let's say you have a rigid beam with a mass in the middle, a lumped mass. So this distance and this distance are the same. Let's call them L. This is rigid and massless. Then you have a spring that is attached here with this stiffness K at a distance of 1.5 L from this end, and you have a damper here located at 3/4 of L. So that's the system. You want to derive the equation of motion. So the objective is derive equation of motion and find damping ratio of the system. Okay. So similar, as I said, to undamped case, we want to basically set up the equation of motion by finding those equivalent components, which now we have one more, being the damping component. In this case, or cases like this, that you can easily set up the free body diagram and directly derive the equation of motion, that's what you do, okay? That's what we have here. Because you see, it's a very simple case. You have a rigid beam, okay? This is the mass. As this oscillates or moves, the system is going to go to a displacement like this, okay? Theta. So you can really see that you can, you with just 1 degree of freedom that you have, you can relate the displacement or the motion of each component to that degree of freedom, which makes it very easy to derive the equation of motion. Okay, so you have a damping force, right? And force of this spring, and this is moving this way, the lumbar force is that way, I theta double dot, and these are the forces at this connection, reaction point. So that's the free body diagram. Somebody's moving in front. That's not good. You have to do your business before coming to class. So anyway, so that's the free body diagram. Okay. So it's easy now, right? So I just take summation of moments, but O is equal to zero. Right? So you have I theta double dot plus this force times the distance plus F of C times 3/4 L plus F of K times 1.5 L is equal to zero, right? Here we have just a lump mass rotating about this fixed point, so we know moment of inertia is just M L squared. What is F of C? F of C is the velocity that times the damping coefficient, right? What is the velocity? The displacement that this damper goes through is this, right? Which is 3/4 L times theta. The displacement that this spring goes through, okay, is 1.5 L theta. So this is displacement velocity would be the derivative of that. So this damping force is this times 3/4 L theta dot. And the stiffness, the spring force would be 1.5 L, which is, this is the distance, right? Theta times K. Substitute these into that equation, you get M L squared theta double dot plus C times 3/4 L theta dot times 3/4 L plus F of K, substitute that in there, you have K times 1.5 L theta times 1.5 L is equal to zero. So if you do this, simplify that, this is what you will get. You get, yeah, as you can see, L squared will cancel out. You can divide this whole thing with just L squared. So you can simplify this, and what you get is M theta double dot plus 9C over 16 theta dot plus 9K over 4 theta is equal to zero. So this is the equation of motion. Wow.
So nobody bothered Norris class.
Okay. I will be here. Okay. So now compare that with MU double dot, C double dot, CU dot, KU. You can see that this is the mass equivalent, this is the C equivalent, this is the K equivalent. So that's how you set up the equation of motion for a physical system. So now that you have that, you know the natural frequency is K over M, so you would 9K over 4 divided by M, so it would be 3 over 2 K over M. You want to find zeta, right? Zeta is C over the critical damping. What is a critical damping? It's 2 square root of K times M. And this is the C equivalent from this equation of motion. So this is what? 9C over 16. So you can simplify that. If you simplify that, you get, okay, you will get 9C over 16 divided by 2 times that, okay? You will get, you get 3C over 16 KM. That's what you will get, okay? Okay. And omega D, of course, then you need to, of course, find, you want to find also omega D, which is 1 minus zeta squared omega N. So you need to just square that, which is 9C squared over 256 KM. And if you substitute this into that equation, and you have K omega N, you get omega D that comes out as, simplify that, 3 over 32 M 256 K M minus 9 C squared. So the whole point of this problem was to show you basically you're given a system like the previous case, how to set up the equation of motion, define the equivalent, you know, coefficients, and find damping ratio in the system. Any question? I'll do one more problem in this category. I said we were going to do two things. Divide the equation of motion for a damped case, and find not just these, but also parameters of the system, zeta, omega, and d, and so on. And the second objective is to demonstrate the application. So let's do one more problem. Let's consider now a similar problem, but in this case, you have a flexible beam. Let's say, instead of that rigid beam, how about if you have a flexible beam with a mass, and you have a damper here that is positioned at this distance, and the mass is at the tip of the beam at rotation L, and you want to derive the equation of motion again, and find, in this case, the problem is asking you to also find omega d. In the previous case, setting up the free body diagram, and by defining that degree of freedom, you could easily directly derive the equation of motion. But what do you do here? You have basically a mass connected to a spring, right? 3EI over L cube, but the damper is here, is not connected to that mass, right? What you need is to have a damper here so that you can basically have this system, the degree of freedom, single degree of freedom system, for which you know the equation is mu double dot plus u dot plus ku. So what do you do now? Any suggestions? How do you do that? How can you move? The question is that I'm raising is it possible somehow to move this damper from where it is to put that in here? Because if you do that, the problem is solved. Yes?
Rayleigh's method?
Beautiful. We learned from Mr. Rayleigh, okay, that if, assuming that this beam, okay, is vibrating and following same pattern as the static displacement, right? And in other words, this is phi x, which was 3/2 x over L squared minus 1/3 x over L cubed. I'm sorry, 1/2. Okay. Oops. This 3 should have been there. So this is 1/2 x over L cubed. In other words, if you have this force here, this force of this damper, what we want to find is an equivalent damping force which does the same job as this damper but positions where we want. So what that means, okay, this is, in order for these two to be equivalent, F of C should generate the same moment about this point that F of C equivalent generates about that point, okay? And we also make the assumption that U of T then can be assumed to be that phi of X, okay, at U of T at point L, okay? That's what we assume. So, therefore, F of C, okay, would be what? Would be C times U dot at basically X is equal to A, right? Times phi of X as is equal to A, right? And the equivalent damper would have the equivalent damping, which is what we want to find, times that U dot times phi at X is equal to L. So substituting in these into this equation results, these U dots of course cancel out, so you have C times phi at A times A is equal to C equivalent times phi at L times L, or C equivalent comes out to be C A phi at A divided by L, because phi at L becomes 1. If you substitute x equal to L, you can see this is just at x equal to L, this phi of L is just 1. So that is the C equivalent. So with that, so what it means now, we have this system. We have a damper with a C equivalent. We have this beam. We know this represents just a spring, and K is 3EI over L cube, and this mass all go through the same displacement. They all experience the same displacement, which is just this displacement of this mass. Therefore, the equation of motion is very simple. Because this system is basically what we had here. M, K, and this. So the equation of motion for this is M U double dot plus C, which is that C equivalent, U dot, plus K, which is that K equivalent, 3EI over L cubed, U is equal to 0. This is the equation of motion. So with that equation of motion given, everything else just follows. Okay? Because this is M, this is C of the system, this is K. So natural frequency is K over M, so 3EI over L cubed divided by M. Damping ratio is C over critical damping, or C, which is the C equivalent, is this one. C, A, phi at A, right, divided by L, divided by 2K times M. This is K, so 3EI over L cubed, right, times M. That's the damping ratio. It's not a nice looking expression, but that's what it will be. And if you evaluate that and so on, I'll just give you the answer. Okay, you will get, well, let's do that. That's okay. Let's do it together. Zeta squared, because you want to derive now omega d, right? So you need to square this, so you have CA squared, phi squared, and A squared divided by 2L squared, and this would be now, okay? This would be actually 4, okay? 4 times 3EI over L cubed M. So you can simplify this a little bit, right? So you have C squared A squared phi of A squared divided by 4, or divided by 12, okay, 12EI M, and I take L here. So that is Z squared, zeta squared, and omega D is 1 minus zeta squared times omega N, which is EI over L 3 times M. So you can simplify this a little bit if you want. If you don't have better things to do, you want to do some more algebra. So you have basically okay, 12 EI M, okay, minus C squared, A squared, V squared, L divided by 12 EI M times EI over L cube M. This EI cancel out, okay? And I guess, and this M, you can take it out of the integral, I mean, out of the, so yeah, that's probably the best we can do. And then take that inside, you can make it a little bit nicer. So you have 12 EI M minus C squared, A squared, V squared, L, right? Divided by L, the 12 L cubed, 1 over M. That's omega D. Okay. All right.
What is omega D?
That's it. Damped. The frequency of the damped system, or the damped natural frequency, quote unquote. Okay. All right. So any questions? Let's do something now more interesting. We want to, as I said, basically what we did, we had two objectives in mind. One, to demonstrate how you set up the equation of motion in case of a damped system, so you can solve the problem and find the response, right? And the second, to demonstrate the application of the free vibration of damped systems. And that's the important part. In fact, what we are going to demonstrate is that how you can evaluate the damping ratio of the system by looking at the response of an underdamped system. As I said, and I emphasize again, the case of underdamped system is the most common case you come across in free vibration or vibration of damped system, and the most practical an important one. One of the applications is how to use the signal or the response of a damped system that you have measured experimentally and find damping ratio from that response. We know this is how a response of an undamped system looks like. Okay, so obviously peak to peak, okay, distance is what? Is one period of the system. It's the period of the system, right? What we want to demonstrate is if you plot U, right, U of T, by looking at the amplitude of, you know that the amplitude is an exponentially decaying function, right? This is what? E to the minus zeta omega n t, right? So what we want to demonstrate is that if you look at any two consecutive amplitudes, this and that, or this and that, by having the value of those two, which you can measure from the experiment, from the signal that you're given, you can actually evaluate the damping ratio in the system. How? Let's call this amplitude U sub n and this U n plus 1, okay? In other words, at time Tn, the amplitude is Un, and at time t n plus one, amplitude is n plus one, okay? We do know this is the response, looks like this, right? You have e to the minus zeta omega n t times, I write one of these forms, a cosine omega dt plus b sine omega dt. If you want, you can convert this to a single sinusoidal function or a cosine function. It doesn't matter. The point is, this is the amplitude. Okay. What is the frequency of this oscillation? Frequency is 1 minus zeta squared times omega f. So you want to find a period. What is the period? The relationship between frequency and period is what? They're inverse of each other, right? 2 pi, of course, factor. This is 2 pi over omega n. Oops. What did I do here? T sub 0 is the natural period of the system. This is the damped period of the system, or the period of the damped oscillation. So we know this relationship, so let's just substitute. So we write 2 pi, okay, over T d is equal to 1 minus zeta squared times 2 pi over t 0. So 2 pi and 2 pi cancel out, and you get t of d, okay, would be t 0 divided by 1 minus zeta squared, okay? This is, as we said, this is t d. So this is what? This is what we had as t, okay. Just to make it clear. All right? So let's now look at this. We are going to look at this ratio of these two amplitudes. In other words, I'm going to look at u n plus 1 over u n, okay? At this point, this is the amplitude represented by this envelope, right, by this function. So you have what? You have e to the minus zeta times omega n, t is tn plus 1, right? And here you have e to the minus zeta omega n tn, right? So let's simplify this. If you simplify this little bit, this is what you will get. You basically, you can, as you can see, this would be what? You have delta, then is e to the minus zeta, right? Omega n, right? I would write that this way, at tn plus td, right? Because this amplitude, Tn, Tn plus 1, is what? Is a Tn plus Td, right? That's what Tn plus 1 is. So I just substitute for that and divide it by, okay, e to the minus zeta omega n Tn, right? So you can see easily that this is basically e minus zeta omega n tn, right, times e to the minus z omega n td divided by e to the minus zeta omega n tn. So this and this cancel out. So you get just e to the minus zeta omega n t d. So this is what that ratio becomes, okay? So if that's the ratio, let's substitute for TD. TD, I will substitute for that. TD is what? Omega D divided by, two pi divided by omega D, right? And of course, omega N, I write that down again, is omega D divided by 1 minus zeta squared. So we just substitute that in there. So you get E delta would be E to the minus zeta times, instead of omega N, I would put this, would be omega D divided by 1 minus zeta squared, right, times TD, which is 2 pi over omega D. Omega D and omega D cancel out, so this becomes E to the minus 2 pi zeta over 1 minus zeta squared. So you can see that basically if you can measure those two amplitudes, right, and the ratio, from this equation, you can find zeta, which is not a bad equation, but we can further actually simplify this relationship. What do? Instead of writing this relationship this way, I take the logarithm from both sides. So I call delta as the log of this big data. So if you take log of this from both sides, would you, you know, this times log of E, which is 1, right? E in the base E, natural log. So you get negative 2 pi zeta over 1 minus zeta squared. So this is easier, right? In other words, if you find the log of that ratio, that's equal to this. If zeta is very small, in other words, if zeta is very small, you can assume this is almost equal to 1. If it's like 0.1, 0.2, 0.1 squared is like 0.001, so it's very, very small. So you can assume this is, which is actually typical, 10%, 20% is typical of the damping ratio of in the physical systems. So this becomes actually even simpler for. So you can find the damping ratio that way, okay? So that's a very practical way to find damping ratio, and we call this method logarithmic decrement method by taking the logarithm of the ratio of those amplitudes, you can find the damping ratio in a system. So this is one of the important applications of free vibration of the damped systems, which, as you can see, is very useful because most of the systems you come across in practice are underdamped. You just measure their free response, which is harmonic with decaying, exponential decaying amplitudes. Find the ratio of two consecutive amplitudes and find the natural for this. I'm sure you probably do this in the lab if you haven't done that already. I don't know. Have you? Or do you know if you're going to do some measurements? You may do other ways. You may use other ways we will discuss also. This is not the only way to find the damping ratio in the system. There are In fact, you learn two or three other ways, but that's one of the easy and most common forms. Any questions? No? Boy, you know, I've always said that for some reason, this is how it goes. I start the day, I'm teaching four sections, okay?